We all have Aunt Betty. You know, the one who pinches your cheeks and pats your perfectly gelled hair and gives you cans of pickled beets. So what do you do with Aunt Betty's pickled beets if you don't like them? To throw it away would be rude, so you put it to the back corner of your pantry and hope to never see it again. We hope that by not looking at it or by hiding it behind delicious jars of jam, they'll disappear. But we all know that it won't. It will sit there gathering dust, but the pickled beets will have the same flavor as the day that Aunt Betty canned them. Sometimes our guilt can be like Aunt Betty's pickled beets. Put them to the back corner of our mind and hope to never think about it again. But it keeps on popping back up again. So we ignore it or try to disguise it, but it is just as painful and heartbreaking as the first day that we felt it. So what do you do with Aunt Betty's pickled beets, or with your guilt? Well, there are multiple actions, but first we're going to discuss some actions that you shouldn't do, then some that you should. You shouldn't flee from guilt, fight with guilt, or fester over guilt. You should forgive, move forward, be free, and focus on God. And I'm even turning into a real preacher, because all of my points start with the same letter, F. Flight, fight, and fester, then forgive, forward, free, and focus. Anyways, God wants you to trade in your guilt for His grace. And today, we're going to understand how to do that. Before we talk about what actions we should and shouldn't take, let's have some context on guilt. Guilt is the remorse and possibly regret after the sin is committed. The sin is past, but the guilt remains. 2 Corinthians 7:10 outlines the two types of guilt, godly sorrow and worldly sorrow. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. Godly sorrow includes the actions we should take, whereas worldly sorrow includes ones that we shouldn't. A situation comparing godly and worldly sorrow is the time-old tale of little Johnny playing ball in the living room, even though his mother told him not to. And guess what? Little Johnny broke his mother's favorite lamp, which in itself is a disobedience, but what he does after determines the type of guilt. If Johnny is truly sorry that he broke the lamp, because he knows his mother would be disappointed by his disobedience, then he would apologize to her and offer to clean it up. This is godly sorrow. Godly sorrow is feeling remorse for the pain that the sin caused to others, and then directly trying to fix the situation. If Johnny instead regrets breaking the lamp, but tries to hide it or replace it, but never apologizes to his mother, then that is worldly sorrow. Worldly sorrow is regretting sinning because the consequences on you personally. Worldly sorrow, just like everything else in this world, will feel good at first, but will lead to pain. Godly sorrow may seem painful at first. I mean, no one likes to admit his sin, but it will save you from future pain. It is all where your focus is, short term or long term. Remember what 2 Corinthians 4:18 says. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Focus on God, and godly sorrow will become easier. Godly sorrow is constructive and produces positive results. Such as Johnny caring for his mother because he cares more. Such as Johnny caring for his mother's belongings because he cares more about his mother. Paul lists the results of a godly sorrow in 2 Corinthians 7:11, the Living Translation. Just see how much good this grief from the Lord did for you. You no longer shrugged your shoulders, but you became earnest and sincere and very anxious to get rid of the sin that I wrote you about. You became frightened about what had happened and longed for me to come and help. You went right to work on the problem and cleared it up, punishing the man who had sinned. You have done everything you could to make it right. In contrast, worldly sorrow gnaws away at you and produces hardness, despair, self-centeredness, lack of trust, and leads to further sin. Bruce Naimore describes godly and worldly sorrow reactions in an apt analogy. Two men are having coffee. One of them reaches over for the sugar and knocks the other man's cup into his lap. A typical guilt reaction would be, how stupidly, I should have known better. Look at the mess I made. I'm sorry. The offender continues to berate himself in his misdeed. Godly sorrow is different. It is constructive. The offender might say, I'm sorry, here are some napkins. I'll get the table cleaned up. And later he might offer to pay the cleaning bill. Godly sorrow focuses on others and fixing the problem, whereas worldly sorrow focuses on the sin and the harmful personal results. The first worldly sorrow action is flight. With the analogy of Aunt Betty's pickled beets, it is to ignore the can and not even look at that part of the pantry. We push away our guilt and try not to think about it, but it keeps on finding us. So we run away, it finds us again, we run away, and it just becomes this vicious cycle of running away but never running to anything. We ignore the guilt because we do not want to face the consequences of the sin. The fact of the matter is that we will have to face our guilt at one time or another, and fleeing from it isn't helping. If anything, it's harming the situation. When we flee from our guilt, we only gain short-term peace, but slowly build a mountain of long-term regret. One time, I had to email a woman back about a possible summer job, but I waited until I got my semester report card. Then I got busy, and longer I waited to email her back, the more guilty I felt. And so I put it off. You see, I had first felt guilty about putting it off for a couple days, then a week, and the longer and longer it was, I didn't want to do it. So that only worsened the problem. When I finally emailed her back a month later, the opportunity had already passed. The same way, when we procrastinate against facing our guilt, we only aggravate the problem. One day it'll be too late, because worldly sorrow brings death. If you flee from your guilt, then you will never give it enough attention to give over to God for Him to fix it. And He knows just how to fix it. In fact, He already has, with three nails, a cross, and a crown of thorns. We must kneel at the foot of the cross, acknowledge our guilt, our brokenness, our need for His redemption, and then the guilt will be lifted. But we need to face it and confess it. Psalms 32:5 says, Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Did you catch that? You forgave the guilt of my sin. Jesus not only died to save you from your sins, but also to release you from your guilt. When we flee from our guilt, we are missing part of God's gift, freedom. Not accepting the release from guilt is like walking around with a broken arm. You're limiting your potential and usefulness by something that could easily be fixed. Fleeing from your guilt will never fix the problem. It will only stunt your Christian growth. Another action of worldly sorrow is fight, which is an active attempt to fix a problem, just not the right one. One attempt to fight is reform. Reform is when you turn over a new leaf and try harder in the future, but in itself, it does not reconcile your past. With the analogy of Aunt Betty's pickled beets, it is to eat sauerkraut instead of pickled beets. But that doesn't mean that it makes the beets go away. It only makes you feel as if a substitution is good enough. It's a mom who had an abortion when she was younger, so now tries to be the best mom ever to her kids, but still carries the guilt of her sin. Reform will wear you down and make you feel like what you do is never good enough. And that's because it's not. Reform alone is trying to earn your way to redemption instead of accepting God's free gift of grace and forgiveness. We cannot deal with or get rid of guilt on our own. True change and repentance is a change of heart, change of will, and change of actions. We may be able to change our will and actions on our own, but we can only change our heart through God. Repentance is turning away from sin and turning towards God. As 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, "If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will heal their land and I will hear them from heaven. I will forgive their sin." To repent, we must do a full 180-degree turn. However, worldly sorrow only does a 90-degree turn. We may turn away from our sin, but if we do not turn towards God, then we lack direction and purpose. With worldly sorrow, we may stop the sin, but we can't ever be released from the guilt of the sin. Just as with fight, flight, and all other worldly sorrows, they're only half actions. By changing our heart to follow Jesus, then our heart, will, and actions will align. We will have fully repented, and we will be released from our guilt. Still, others try to fight guilt, but they go to the wrong person or place. The perfect example of this is Judas, Jesus' betrayer. When Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse and returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and to the elders. "I have sinned," he said, "for I have betrayed innocent blood." "What is that to us?" they replied. "That's your responsibility." So Judas threw the money into the temple and left, then went away and hanged himself. Judas hanged himself when Jesus was still alive. He just went to the wrong people for forgiveness. Could you imagine if Judas had gone to Jesus instead of the chief priests for forgiveness? It would have been the best redemption story in all of history. Jesus, beaten, bloodied, and broken, forgiven the man who handed him over to be killed and who had sealed the deal with a kiss. And Jesus would have forgiven him, which means that no sin, no guilt is too dark or too deep or too big for Jesus to forgive. So turn to him for forgiveness and relief from sin. Turn to him, don't turn to the bottle. Turn to him, don't turn to the flesh. Turn to him, don't turn to food. Turn to him, and he will not only wash away your sin and your guilt, but he will place his peace, his strength, his wisdom in you, with you. Jesus takes away our guilt and fills the emptiness with his Holy Spirit. Don't fight your guilt. Turn to God, and he will forgive it. The other worldly sorrow is fester, which is to continually wallow in guilt without taking action. Fester is the exact opposite of flight. It is to think and analyze your guilt constantly, whereas flight is to ignore your guilt. With the analogy of Aunt Betty's pickled beets, it is to open the can and set it on the kitchen table, but do nothing about it. Mold starts to grow on the can and begins to stink up the whole house as a constant reminder of your guilt. To fester, in a physical sense, means to be infected and rot, but it's also true of the spiritual sense. We are infected by sin, and the ensuing pain and discomfort are sin's consequences, one of which is guilt. If you allow your guilt to fester, then it will gnaw and rot away at you. When your guilt is your focus, you can't move forward. You can't drive only looking in the rearview mirror, and neither can you live while you're only focusing on your past. God wants you to be free. He doesn't want you to fester over your sin. If he did, then he would have only given us a book of rules to show how we have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. But that isn't the end of the story or the sentence. And all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. We must not overemphasize the sin and underemphasize the Savior, because the Savior is why we have hope, why and how we can have relief from the pains of this world, why we smile. God wants us to be free to the point that he took it upon himself to free us. God took our burdens, our guilt, our sin to pay for our freedom. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Matthew 11:28-30. Trade your guilt for his grace. God isn't some distant, judgmental, crotchety old man. He is a man of action. He gets the job done. No matter the blood, sweat, and tears, he will and did pay for them. He got down in the dirt. He became one of us and died like one worse than us so that we don't have to. Don't let that go to waste. You must make the choice to leave your guilt in the past, accept God's grace, and move forward with our lives. Even more, our guilt and sin is attached to our old life. But in Christ's death, we have new life. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone. The new is here. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Our guilt should not and does not come with us into our new lives. We are free from all the bonds of our past when we accept God's grace. Repentance, the confession of sin, even for a long-time Christian, can be like becoming a new Christian for the first time all over again. We continually start new lives in Christ each day, which means by repentance, we do not have to live with guilt. Psalms 103:12 says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has God removed our transgressions from us. The same is true in our new and old lives. If I start walking to Lake Michigan and then Wyoming, the Pacific Ocean, China, Italy, and right back here, I will always be heading west. The west and the east never meet. Thus, our guilt should be that much far away from us when we are in Christ. There is no reason to fester over guilt, but there is every reason to move forward. Now we are shifting from what we shouldn't do, worldly sorrow, to what we should do, godly sorrow. David outlines his experience with godly sorrow in Psalm 51, about committing adultery with Bathsheba. He confesses his sins, asks to be cleansed, and approaches God with a broken spirit. Verse 17 says, my sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, you, God, will not despise. Contrite means to be affected by guilt, but the root of the word makes it interesting, to grind or wear down. A contrite heart is a humble and tired heart. God wants us to acknowledge our brokenness so that he can fully and completely mend us. Many of the problems that ensnare those with worldly sorrows is that they rely on themselves to relieve their guilt and not on God. After coming to God with a contrite heart, the next step is to forgive. And forgiveness should come in three parts: God's, others, and your own. God already has forgiven you through his son's blood on the cross, but you need to accept that forgiveness for it to be felt. Forgiveness of God and others is intertwined. As Matthew 6:14 says, for if you forgive others when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. You should seek forgiveness from others, if possible. But also remember that everyone heals at different speeds. If someone else holds a grudge, that does not mean that you can't move forward. Remember to take all possible opportunities to witness God's grace and try to reconcile. Also, you need to forgive yourself. It seems strange, but sometimes the hardest person to forgive is yourself. Forgiveness does not mean justifying your sin or excusing it. Forgiveness is saying that God is greater than your past. Just as Judas characterized worldly sorrow, Peter characterizes godly sorrow as both sinned against Jesus, but only Peter turned away from sin and turned towards God. When I was researching for this sermon, I yet again found about why God is amazing. In the Gospel of Matthew, the account of Peter's denial, Matthew 26, and the account of Judas' suicide, Matthew 27, were right next to each other. It is as if God is saying you have two choices, godly or worldly sorrow. Peter used his past as a type of motivation. He denied knowing Jesus three times, which is maybe why later in Acts he was so strong in his belief in acknowledging Christ before others. Judas made his sin a reason not to move forward, whereas Peter made his sin a reason to move forward. The best way to move forward is to move forward with a purpose. And the greatest purpose a Christian can have is to share the good news, to follow God. David did just this in Psalms 51:12-13. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways so that the sinners will turn back to you. David turned away from his sin, turned towards God, and moved forward by teaching others about God. Moving forward and following God grows you as a Christian and helps to keep temptations away. Guilt is stagnation, but following God is progression. We must not let the mistakes and sins of our past prevent the opportunities of our future. We have a duty, a Christian duty, to move forward because living in the past only leads to stagnation. In moving forward, we can find opportunities to share the gospel and to free others from their own guilt. We can learn from Paul in Philippians 3:13-14 about moving forward and focusing on God. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Focusing on Jesus and the hope he brings is beneficial and is the best way to keep your guilt in the past. It is not going to be easy. It is going to be a constant battle. But God is with you and you must focus on him. Just as Jesus said in Luke 9:23, then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. We must also daily focus on God and not on our guilt, to follow him and not flee, fight, or fester. So forgive, move forward, be free, and help others find Jesus and the relief he gives, just as you have experienced. Finally, throw those pickled beets into the garbage and tell Aunt Betty that you don't like them. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for saving us from our sins and releasing us from our guilt. Thank you for your love and kindness. Give us the strength to focus on and follow you. In your words, we put our hope and trust. Amen.